So what I like to do is to give you a little bit of impression how theosophy is working and what the consequences are if you're speaking about philosophy. And we learned from Carolyn that, if I use my own words, it is a time of framework. And for me, it is important, what do you put in that frame? What is the basis of your reasoning? And how consequent can you be in this? And what I have done, let's see if it works, that shows you that there is not much difference between theosophy and science. Because theosophy starts from his propositions, fundamental propositions. And science starts from his hypothesis. And if you look in the dictionary, and you like to have a good definition of both of them, you see that some dictionaries are almost equal in definition. Some dictionaries see quite a difference in it. And it is just the difference what I like to use to see that it needs an active, motivation to do something. So the hypothesis people say, you do observations, you do collect data, and from there you make your predictions. And that is a very common, process in the science world. But if you see the idea of propositions, then you see that it is a more philosophical base. And it is without any, and that is an important thing, without any assumption of truth. Imagine yourself, if we take the first fundamental proposition of the secret doctrine, and we like to prove that for ourselves, there's quite a job. In principle, you need infinite life and able to look back to see that at one, principle, immutable and omnipresent, is a fact. And still, we take it for, as a logic basis. Yeah. Hypothesis should be able to make a prediction of on a limit amount of evidence, and that is a very important difference. So the fundamental propositions, we take them as, as basic points to start from. And the second proposition and the third are easier to find some evidence for yourself. But the first one is the hardest. Yeah. So both need investigation and proof for yourself. So that means activity. So you have the top-down approach, that you mean you start from the global approach and you make for yourself a number of propositions and facts. The bottom-up is dus very popular in the science world. You do your investigations, you look around, you see a number of data, and how the data is looking like, you start to build your hypothesis on it. Yeah? And that, of course, means that there is a very strong limitation between your conclusion and the data. And in science, quite often we see that we have update our data or we find new data and we have to come back to our hypothesis. So the most important thing for us as theosophists is, how can we come from propositions to hypothesis? And the main thing is that we have to avoid belief. That means an active process. If we take the fundamental propositions of the secret doctrine as something to start from, yeah, we have to realize that we have to do for ourselves, and that is a very individual process, observations to see if it will lining up with the propositions. If you don't do that, and we say, oh, it sounds nice, and yeah, why not? Then we start to make a believer of theosophy. And this is a very important thing, because with a belief, after a while, you can ask yourself, why should I study anymore? It is for me fine, I have an idea, I can live with it. But if you really want to become it, and you want to develop yourself, and you want to grow, and you want to make logic for your fellow men, then you should really do these investigations yourself. And that is an important thing. What is a proof? And that is a very individual thing. What is a proof for me, maybe is not a proof for you, and vice versa. So that means that we build our own true, with small letters, you can say, and we have to go around. And it is very dynamic, yeah? So there can happen things in life that really shakes you in your ideas. You have to go back to basic observations and rethink them. And if we say, in theosophy, there is no chance, everything is karmic, then sometimes we can have, experience some situations what can be very hard to explain how that will work. So that is the three fundamental propositions of the secret doctrine, but you find them in many other places, propositions. For instance, in Newton, Huygens, was a Dutch physicist, Einstein. They make their propositions, and we are still in the process to prove them. Newton describes very well how gravity is working. He is not explaining what gravity really in principle is. Yep. So it is only the behavior what he described. And he has made a bold statement, and we're still in that process to prove it. Huygens is the one who comes very close to the ideas you find in the secret doctrine about monads and how monads would work with monads. And Einstein, of course, we know with his propositions about relativity and all the consequences for this. But still we are in the process to prove that Einstein is right. Not everything what he is... what he states in his investigation, is in his documentation, is proven yet. The very famous question, to becoming old or not becoming old, if you travel with the speed of life, and so on, is not yet proven. It's just a type of mathematical consequences out the other things he puts there. Yeah. So, and then of course, the hypothesis, theosophy, universes, prenatates each other, yeah? So that is a very important one, yeah? So that means that the universe, and we have studied that yesterday in the terms of religion, is one fundamental thing what goes through everything. That is, you can say, the basis of all. Yeah, and we have tried to describe that, and my favorite description is always coming from Lao Tse, Tao, what can be named, is not the true Tao. Yeah. We have to, I just put here the three fundamental principles in short, and then have only taken the keywords from it, and so that you can have an idea where we speak about, but that is something what you all should know, I think. If you see the three fundamental principles and you ask yourself, what is the practical implementation of that three fundamental principles? Yeah, then I think you can see that there are seven coming from it, seven very practical. You will find them everywhere in the secret doctrine, but in our Point Loma tradition, we use them quite often, the seven jewels, in combination with each other, because with this seven, you can explain everything what happens in life. Every observations can be explained by this seven, and this seven is finding the basis in the three fundamental propositions. So you can say it is a type of a help to make things more practical for us. The key idea of this is, of course, that we have to realize that if we as theosophists don't apply philosophy based on the three fundamental principles, and we're searching in life for a practical evidence of this, our building our own hypothesis, then we come in the situation that it starts to become a belief. And we have to realize this process is a very individual process. And we can help each other by just exchanging how we are coming to these conclusions. And sometimes it takes a long time. To give you a very practical example, in the city where we are living, parking your car in the front of your house is something what will not happen very often. The street is always crowded and you should be happy you find a place. And then I ask myself, if there is no chance and everything is karmic, what is the process in this situation? Sometimes I'm coming home from my work in the time I was still working outside. And then still I found my own place leaving from this morning. Sometime holiday was a little bit more difficult. I had to take another place. And then I was able to take that other place for a couple of days. And then I was losing my place on another one. And if you start to observe this, in my mind, there should be a logic behind it. It looks very random in the first things. And then, of course, by thinking, you realize, okay, when I'm leaving the home for going to work, someone else working in our neighborhood is coming and take my place. When he leaves from his work, that is almost the time I'm coming from my work. Yeah, so that explains a little bit. And then you see that there is a certain pattern in the street. For us, if I come in late from lectures on Friday evening, it is almost impossible that you can park in our street because all the people using that places. What I like to say by this very simple example is there is a karmic explanation. Of course, I was not aware of all individual motivations why people are coming and going, but just by observation for a while, you see there is a logic in the whole system. Maybe not a very nice logic, not a very, let's say, easy to predict logic, because you have to know more parameters for that, but there was logic in it. Yeah? And you can make use of that. This is just an example that if you go from karma, then we should be consequent and really looking for what is the reason what brings me always in this situation. Yeah, I know people what always having a leg problem during the Christmas days, year after year. What is the logic in it? If you observe that situation, it was quite simple to answer. Christmas Day in the Netherlands, that was family and cooking and a lot of cooking, a lot of this and stress and stress and stress. And yes, of course, under stress, we was not very careful by doing things, and it happens again. Yeah? Logic. Yeah? So you can learn from that. Don't stress if you have to do a lot of cooking for a lot of people with Christmas. Yeah? It is very, very simple and practical. But what I like to say, if we are consequent, yeah? And if we take, for instance, the second fundamental propositions, and we speak about cyclic things, then we should be able to make use of that information in a positive sense. We can make, and of course, every farmer can tell you that there is a process what you should respect if you want to have your growing and your food, etc., etc. You cannot do that through the whole year. Of course, Dutch people are a little bit stubborn, and we have glass houses, and we try to do it the whole year. But that quality of food is not the same quality of food what you get if you do it in the proper cycle of the year. Yeah? So that are very simple examples. What I like to say by this is, take the three fundamental propositions and work with them. Try to see in your daily life, if I'm able to recognize them, can I see them? And if you see them, you collect data and you can build for yourself a bigger, let's say, motivation and bigger evidence for that they still really practical and very useful. So that is the philosophy. We built a philosophy around the three fundamental propositions. And of course, we will have questions that will not easily be answered. Keep in the back of your mind. After a while, I can tell you, you see other evidence, you combine it, and things become much more clear. I think this will be a nice step for our remaining part of the day, and try to be working with philosophy and to make something very practical out of it. And we can use the seeker doctrine very much, with all the information is in it, and certainly the three propositions. Thank you.